Thank you to CuriosityStream and Nebula for sponsoring me. You can get access to extended and ad-free versions of my videos by signing up with the link in my description. Hello there everyone, I'm Soph. To be honest, I've left my notes at home, but let's just spring into it anyway. So I'm out here on this unexpectedly warm April day because, I'm gonna be honest, I got caught out by Fool's Spring. Now Fool's Spring, if you don't know, is like that couple of days that tends to come, for at least us in the Northern Hemisphere, at like end of March, early April, and it's a day that's like unusually warm. And what happens is Fool's Spring triggers the spring feeling in me, and from then onwards, there's no going back. I basically find myself going outside at every opportunity to soak up every little ounce of primavera I can get. Which brings me here to my lovely little picnic blanket in the middle of the park. Now for some people, the spring feeling may not be a positive one, and I'll talk a little bit about that more later. But for me at least, it's that hopeful, happy, warming sense that things are getting going and the goings are getting brighter. And it's a really tangible thing for me, I find, and a few other people seem to agree with me. I can like set aside spring feeling as a mood that's kind of separate from everything else. I can give it that specific label. It's like I have a specific Christmassy feeling, I have a specific spring feeling. It turns out there's a few potential reasons for this. One of the big ones is that days are getting longer. Sunlight affects the release of a particular chemical in our brain called melatonin. The crows are having a mad one today. Am I on their territory? Science sleepy chemical, melatonin. Melatonin, as I just shouted quietly, makes us sleepy. Sunlight represses its production. It stops it being released in your brain. Less melatonin makes you less sleepy and so more awake and active. Ergo sun, more sun makes you less sleepy. So in winter, when there's less sunlight, we tend to be more lethargic. Then from March 20th onwards, us lot in the Northern Hemisphere experience longer days, are exposed to more sunlight per day, and so get clearer stay awake signals in our brains. This is a key springtime feature and could contribute to a springtime feeling. Another chemical relationship to sunshine is that of serotonin. Various studies have shown that the more hours of daylight there are, the higher the levels of serotonin in our brains. Now, I haven't found a direct mechanism for how this actually happens, but it's a pretty well-established link. All your body's chemicals are super complex and often get simplified down, and serotonin is a classic example of this. It has loads of different effects on your body depending on where it is and what it's interacting with. There's a lot of serotonin in your digestive system, for example, but it's most known for its role as a mood stabilizer and its relationship to life satisfaction and reduced depression. This aspect of serotonin could mean its increased levels during sunshiny days are also a reason for a springtime mood boost. Spring is also the season when your brain is most sensitive to opioids, which are also chemicals that regulate your mood and how sociable you feel. Your brain's more sensitive to them in spring than in summer even. This chemically boosted mood and alertness and want to socialize all tie into the other key aspect of longer days, and that's that there's basically just more time to get outside and meet in big groups and exercise outside. And those are all things that trigger endorphin release. For me, I like to combine all three of them by doing bicep curls with a pint in a beer garden. And even though we haven't been able to be as sociable as normal during COVID, the chemical changes I've discussed still have an impact. We're not the only ones who react to springtime, of course. It's a huge time of change for the flora and fauna of the natural world. Flowers are blooming, birds are singing, and thanks to the longer and supposedly warmer days, some of us can fortunately go outside and experience these things more. We can strip away the layers of jumpers and woolies and get more precious skin in the sun for some of that sweet, sweet vitamin D. Although, again, public service announcement, be wary of Fool's Spring. Don't put away your winter wardrobe too soon. My partner taught me this French saying that I always ignore and then regret ignoring. En avril, ne te découvre pas d'un fil. En mai, fais ce qu'il te plaît. Whether you're correctly dressed or not, being outside has tons of benefits on us wee little humans. That's why the Japanese practice of forest bathing, or Shinrin-yoku, is so popular. It's been shown that sitting in a forest and really just taking in your surroundings can decrease your heart rate and blood pressure. Unless it's not a forest, it's a bit of grass near a road and you're trying to film a video. Now that forest bathing stuff might all sound a bit hippy-dippy, and personally I think there's nothing wrong with that. I love a tree cuddle as much as the next child of the earth. But there's actually scientific backing for many of the positive benefits of being in nature. As I mentioned in my work from home video a while ago, trees release chemicals called phytoncides, which have been shown to boost our white blood cell count when we breathe them in. In other words, they boost our immune systems. So sniffing a tree can be good for your health. Maybe hug it first though, you know, take it a step at a time. If you're gonna get a bit more down and dirty, then there's a bacteria found in the soil called Mycobacterium vacae. That, if it gets into your body, has been shown to boost the release of, here it is again, serotonin. So once you've done sniffing some trees, sniff some soil. I've actually always loved smelling soil and moss, and now it makes sense. And also, something else I learned is that the smell microbes make as they break down plants in the soil is known as geosmin. That's that really earthy smell that, for example, makes beetroot taste like ground. If you can't get out and stick your nose in Mother Nature though, don't worry. If where you are you can hear birdsong, then you may also be experiencing benefits. Although I do understand that if it's difficult for you to get into nature, it's also probably difficult for you to hear birds. But the benefits of birdsong have been shown in a few studies, mainly ones that come from giving people questionnaires, but these studies suggest that hearing birdsong can help you feel less stressed. Even though birdsong is basically just a way for them to be like, go away, or come to mama. But we hear it and we're like, oh yeah, love that, so calming. Although the relaxation effect on you does depend on which birds you're hearing songing. Those crows earlier weren't relaxing though, oh my gosh, I thought my days were numbered. The sounds either had to be nice, like a melodic songbird, or the person listening had to have positive associations with hearing that particular bird. Like pigeons, for example, hearing pigeons just made a lot of people irrationally angry. Now this is something I actually really relate to, not the pigeon anger thing. Pigeons, I can take them or leave them. But the bird song relaxation thing is something I really relate to. I was actually really struggling when I was researching this video. I don't know, I've recently moved flat and maybe a global pandemic has had a bit of an impact on my productivity, but who am I to guess, right? But either way, I put on some bird song and it really helped. And two of my favorite bird calls to hear are ones that I have positive associations with. So there's the wood pigeon, the cuckoo, because that reminds me of my caravan in Wales, which is my favourite place in the world to be, a bar maybe Blackpool Pleasure Beach. And the other one is that one that goes, which I actually heard when I came to sit down to film today, because to me that bird song is just the sound of spring, and it brings back so many memories of sitting on warm grass with cold drinks and corn cocktail sausages laughing with mates. Oh, it's just the best. I love how the birds have got really noisy while I do the bird song section, that's really cute. But that brings me on to a key facet of the spring feeling. So much of it is about association. The early evening walks, the sight of unfurling leaves, the sound of the birds singing, and the smells of jasmine and wisteria. They're all things that we've come to associate with springtime coming and things opening up again. Opening up again having an even bigger meaning during COVID. We associate them with our brain serotonin boost and an awake feeling of contentment. The smells are an interesting one actually, because researching this video, I found out that of all the senses, evidence suggests that smell is the one most directly linked to memory in the brain. Your olfactory bulb processes smells, and your hippocampus is a part of your brain important for recalling events. All other sensory areas of your brain, so those related to like touch and sight or whatever, they interact with the hippocampus via other areas, whereas the olfactory bulb interacts with it directly. It's the only one with hippocampal speed dial set up. That's why smells can conjure up really powerful memories, often more vividly than any other sense. There we go, sun's less in my eyes now, perfect. But going back to associations, with them being such a key part of the spring feeling, the problem with them is that they're not always positive. And so if spring doesn't have positive associations for you, then that spring feeling may be one of anxiety and discomfort. This could be because a negative life event occurred to you in the middle of spring, and so all the bird song and leaf changing and everything I'm waxing about may actually bring back negative memories. Or it could be that you don't really like the boosted socializing and busier outdoorsing that is expected of you and that happens around you during springtime. Or maybe you're body conscious and you don't want to go out in warmer weather because that means that you may end up having to wear fewer layers. Spring is a time of sudden changes. One minute you're in the dark parsnip-filled days of winter, and the next just sitting on a picnic blanket eating strawberries. And all these changes, both external and internal, are things I've listed so far as generally positive and a reason for hope. But many people find such a sudden shift jarring, with the passage of time shoved under their noses like bacterium-riddled soil. And the expectation that you'll have a cheery outlook if you don't often makes things even bleaker. And I kind of touched on it briefly earlier, but if you can't can't go outside or don't have any access to nature's benefits, then they're not necessarily going to help you out either. One really interesting example of the flip side of the springtime positives is in the context of that increased springtime sensitivity to opioids that I mentioned earlier. Our body makes natural opioids, endorphins being an example of these, but they can also be obtained through drugs like morphine and codeine. Spring is actually the time when people with opioid addictions are most likely to attempt suicide. And so whilst boosted sensitivity to opioids can have positive impacts for many, if you're already dealing with addiction and suddenly your brain is even more sensitive to an opioid need, then that could make your life a lot more difficult. Historically even, spring hasn't always been associated with sunshine, roses and wood pigeon cooing. Spring fever is actually a phrase relating to poor health. Limited fresh fruit and veg over winter meant that by spring, people had generally used up their vitamin C stores and so were more likely to get ill. While springtime does signal a time where diet can generally improve and people tend to eat fewer energy and fat building carbs to kind of keep you warm over winter, it can take a while for those effects to kick in. I wanted to point out here that spring isn't great for everyone, because as someone who is completely enamored with it as a season and with the wood pigeons that emerge, it is something that I often forget. And to be honest, when I started researching this video, I didn't even consider that I would have a section about spring being bad. I thought it would just be like, a spring fangirl talks about the science of spring. And yes, it does make sense that spring has a particular feeling. Every one of your senses has changes it adjusts to, triggering cascades of internal responses and mental associations. But of course, everyone is different, and so that feeling that spring has will be different for everyone. So just remember to still check in on your mates and see what their spring feeling is. Speak of checking with mates.
And your time, Soph's notes, is pretty much up.
What? But I have a whole other bit with that. Stop talking. Did you follow me here?
No. I'm literally everywhere at all times. Don't flatter yourself.
Oh. Anyway, you need to wrap this up because you're getting a bit long, yeah? I've not decided what the ideal video length is going to be by the time you post this, but you're already edging towards it, so.
But I have some interesting experiments to talk about.
If I didn't have to hold this camera right now, yeah? I'd be aggressively tapping my watch. All right, then, I'll just talk about it on Nebula.
Oh, not this again.
For those of you who don't know.
Everyone knows by now.
And those of you who do, Nebula is a streaming service for thoughtful and educational content. I post extended versions of my videos on there before they go up on YouTube and with absolutely zero ads. So over on Nebula, I've donned my snazzy black lab coat.
Please ignore stereotypes. I just have a new lab coat and I wanted to wear it.
So go into a bit more detail about some of the experiments that came up with the spring feeling findings that I've discussed in this video.
Yawn.
You see, the YouTube algorithm is a fickle mistress.
Oh, hello.
Not a compliment, which is why myself and tons of other creators have set up Nebula. It means we can worry less about whatever the algorithm's in the mood for that month.
I'm kind of feeling like a misinformation vibe at the moment.
Exactly. What are you doing, right? On Nebula, there's both extended versions of what we put on YouTube, but also totally original content that you can't find anywhere else. Misinformation is never our vibe.
Nerd!
And another thing that makes me proud of Nebula is that even though we're a creator-built platform, built from scratch, we're getting recognised by one of the biggest fish in the educational video pond, or stream, I guess. Curiosity Stream. They recognise our aim to prioritise thoughtful educational content, and so we've teamed up together. If you sign up to Curiosity Stream, you get free access to Nebula. On Curiosity Stream, you can watch thousands of documentaries. My current fave gem that I've discovered is this series hosted by Miranda Cosgrove, i.e. the know-it-all kid from School of Rock, about women doing amazing things in STEM fields, or science, tech, engineering and maths. Each 20-minute episode is packed with cool findings from all sorts of different areas of science. It's just brilliant. And what's more, all this is super affordable. By going to curiositystream.com/SoSnotes, you can get access to Curiosity Stream and Nebula for a year for just $14.79. This is not a drill, it's a great deal. To anyone already signed up, I really, really appreciate it. Although, you're probably not watching this ad, right? You're probably watching over on Nebula. And to anyone who does sign up, I appreciate it in advance, and I'll see you over there. Thanks so much for listening. All right. Okay, I'm on the wind down part of the script now. That's it for now, though, everyone. Like this video if you like it, share it if you share it, subscribe if you subscribe it, comment with what your spring feeling is, positive or negative, and media my socials if you want to do that. Otherwise, all that's left to say is thank you so much for watching, have a lovely day, and remember to keep on sniffing with permission. And a huge thank you to my wonderful patrons, with a special science word shout out to newcomer Kyle Randall, hello, and a hello to Angela Drove, Brent, Adam, Terry, and Justin. Is it on you? Hello, everyone, come to mama! it's a dog or a rat. And to be honest, I didn't even really expect to mention it. My little wood pigeon. Oh, that makes me so happy.
Oh, I'm too excited, my mouth's dry.
Opening up, the crows have eyes. I'm toasting away, it's cozy. It's hot, it is hot out here. You made it to the end. Here's a link to a playlist of my favourites. Here's a link to a video I've specially picked out for you to see. And here's a link to my Patreon. Au revoir.